my dear friends, click on the like button, that is the thumbs up button, press the subscribe button and the bell icon, and don't forget to follow me on Instagram.
Hi guys, and welcome to another vlog. And I am riding this motorcycle, the Indian Scout Bobber, and these are the keys of the motorcycle, and this is the motorbeam keychain which Dhanal has made. So as you can see, this motorcycle looks absolutely smashing. It's based on the Scout, and the design needs full marks, completely full marks. Just look at the fat front tire. That's a 130/90/16. What an amazing design. Honestly, if I just ride this motorcycle all around now, then I'll become very famous. The attention to detail, OMG, Indian, you guys totally rock in terms of attention to detail. Right from this Indian Scout written on the tank to the V-twin motor. Look at this attention, how it's polished. Wow, what a machine. There's even piano black finish on the lever as well as on the crash guard of this motorcycle. And it's a single seat. Seat seems very nice, leather finishing there, and this one gets this accessory which is optional obviously, wherein you can actually mount your luggage. So twin exhaust, ABS. The rear tire is a 150 section. It's 150/80/16, and look at the minimalistic rear. I don't know where the brake light has gone right now. Look at these indicators, the attention there, and it gets a bell drive. Love the design of this Indian motorcycle. Look at this, the connector for the gear lever, and this is where the ignition key of this motorcycle is. So put it here, and that's where it turns on. Steel braided brake lines, really good quality finishing on this motorcycle. The front has a round headlight. And I think there's less to talk and more to ride. So let's get on the saddle right away. So first, let me turn on this motorcycle. And here we go. So let's talk about the console quickly. Now there's a button over here, wherein you can change this analog digital clusters display. So right now it's showing total kilometers. There's a clock. There's a trip meter. There's a tachometer, engine temperature. DC electricals tells you how much wattage is there and total kilometer, obviously odometer, and this is the RPM meter. So we are on RPM meter. There's this speedometer here marked at 200 kilometers per hour and telltale lights in between. Let's slot it into first gear. It's actually already in first gear, and right now I'm going to struggle to turn it around. So this bike doesn't weigh much. It is just 255 kgs, which isn't a lot honestly. And here we are on the move. Seems quite comfortable, but oh my god, the acceleration is very good and very fast. Let me adjust the mirrors. Now the design is typical of an Indian, but these mirrors are so hard to move around. Honestly, I won't be able to see much of what's behind. And around the corners, it feels so great and so inspiring. I mean, I have never felt so comfortable and sure-footed around a corner on a bobber style motorcycle. Obviously, this motorcycle rivals two other very interesting motorcycles. One is obviously the Triumph Bonneville Bobber, and the other is the Harley Davidson Street Bob, which I recently rode. And here we are, and as I give it the beans, it just picks up pace so fast. There are some vibrations which can be felt on the foot pegs and obviously on the handlebar, but the vibrations on the pegs are much, much, much greater. Let me apply brakes and see how the brakes are. Good stopping power. The front has a 298mm disc. The rear also has a 298mm disc. Indian becomes kind of lazy to, you know, give a different size rear disc. So they give the same front one. Even they did the same with the Indian Chieftain, the Dark Horse, which I was riding recently. Brakes are really very good, very sure-footed. So this motorcycle is powered by a 1133cc V-twin motor, 8-valve, liquid-cooled. And boy oh boy, it produces some punch. So power output is 94 at 8000 rpm. Meanwhile, the torque output is 97 newton meters at a rather late 5600 rpm by cruiser standards. And I have to duck down to see what's around because the mirror just won't adjust. Oh my god, this Optra is smoking. The engine does get rough, and there are a lot of vibrations, and there are also a lot of false neutrals. So the gearbox isn't the slickest around. It is a 6-speed unit. And as I give it the beans, I realize there are too many vibrations, especially post 4,500 rpm. But I don't understand why the torque output is coming so later on. So that's the reason why this doesn't feel so punchy lower down like you would expect from a cruiser style motorcycle. And as I stop here, it easily comes into neutral. I'm going to make another attempt to fix the mirror. Ah, slightly better, not the best. Here we are in first gear, time to go. Now I'm in first gear and believe you me, it does 100 kilometers per hour, almost 100 kilometers per hour in first gear. 95 at 8250 rpm in first itself. That is amazing, but the vibes are just too much. Okay, V-twin motors have a lot of vibrations always, that's the case, but they are unbearable right now for me. And I need to upshift now at 130 kilometers per hour in second gear. Holy cow, my hands are vibrating like mad. Oh my lord, they should have cut the RPM to around 6000 RPM only, because the buzzing on the pegs and on the handlebar is just insane. Insane buzzing. Oh my goodness, I am actually thinking that Royal Enfield motorcycles are more refined. That's the kind of vibrations and buzzing which I can feel right now at lower RPM. False neutral. This isn't a motorcycle to ride flat out, although it will give you a lot of pace when you go flat out. So 0 to 100 kilometers per hour just takes 4.5 seconds, provided you get your first to second upshift right. And now in third gear, as I open the throttle, there's just so much surge. Power delivery is very linear as such. Refinement is great lower down. But as I give it the pin in the upper revs, it just doesn't feel refined. And oh my goodness, this is such a smooth road. And I can feel a lot of bumps on my ass already. And that's all thanks to the fact that this has a suspension which has just 50 mm of suspension travel. And I think I'm going to fly away from the motorcycle because there's obviously a lot of wind blast. But I am not staying glued to the road. Here we are ducking down. And 160 kilometers per hour, absolutely effortless. Almost 180. So there is a lot of pull from this motor, but the suspension kind of sucks. At the front, we have 41 mm telescopic forks. At the rear, we have twin shock absorbers with just 50 mm of suspension travel. That's very poor suspension travel. In fact, the suspension travel is so poor that every time you go over a bump on a smooth road like this also, you can feel everything on your back. The ground clearance is also very low, so it is just 129 mm, which also means that every time you try to lean hard, and the maximum lean you can go is 29 degrees, that every time you lean hard, the foot pegs are going to scrape. And the bigger problem is that the right twin exhaust, they tend to hit stuff on speed breaker. So you can see there are marks already over there. The pegs are front set. The clutch isn't very light, I would say, but decently light, very much usable. The seat height of this motorcycle is just 649 mm, which means that every time you sit on it, you'll be very comfortable, even for short riders. So here we are, ready to give it the beans. Now, left foot on the clutch, right foot on the throttle, and there is no launch control. There are no engine modes. It does have traction control, which will ensure that you don't wheel spin, and no chance of wheelie either. Here we go. Moronic gearbox. This is the worst gearbox I've seen on a cruiser motorcycle after Royal Enfield, obviously. And look at the way it pulls. Oh my lord, I'm doing 180 in no time. This engine offers way more punch than what Harley Davidson Street Bob does. And as I step on the brakes, I realize they are very short-footed. And I know, I have said it 4-5 times, I know. But I can't help but talk about the brakes. They're so good on this motorcycle. So ABS works very well. At almost 180 kilometers per hour at 8250 rpm, and my goodness, this motorcycle has more performance than you can actually extract out of it, because you don't have the bodge. You're just going to fly away all the time because of the wind, because you're not seated so comfortably. These are a couple of problems that need to be dealt with, and the handling is quite good. In fact, the Reason for that good handling is that the suspension really has very little travel, and it's very easy to push it around corners and maintain your line. So definitely very good in terms of that. And here we are yet again. Now I hope to get the shift right. Here we go. The crappiest gearbox I have ever witnessed on a motorcycle. How can they make such a shit gearbox? I still can't understand. Doesn't shift from first to second, always getting into fast neutral. Very disappointed with Indian. So I was saying the handling is very nice and sure-footed. You can really turn it around corners without having to worry. Only thing is that, you know, you will end up scraping the pegs. Otherwise, it is a very nimble handler. Sure-footed, definitely. And now I'm going to go for another attempt to get the 0 to 100 km per hour done right. I'm sorry, I'm messing up, but this gearbox is absolutely rubbish. And here we go once again. No, it will not shift. I think I'll have to launch it in second now. Per hour, it does pull like a mad machine, this bobber. And it's really the styling where it nails it, because it looks so fantastic. Wow. So here we are, yet another attempt to get the 0 to 100 km per hour right. Traction control system is quite aggressive, like no way it's going to give you a wheelie, although it does seem like it will at any given point of time. Here we are. Now I'm hoping I will get the gear shift right. And here we go, 3, 2, 1, go. Yes, we did. Holy mother of God, it's still pulling, and I'm doing already almost 200 kilometers per hour. My lord, what a machine, what an engine. They have nailed it with the engine, minus the vibration and the fuzziness, which can be felt otherwise. Wow, almost 200 kilometers per hour on a bobber style motorcycle, where you are actually leaning a bit forward. The riding position isn't that great, front set pegs and whatnot, but trust me, this motorcycle is so fun to ride. Minus this gearbox, which won't shift. Come on man, just shift. Honestly, the speedometer feels like a tachometer. That's how it pulls. Every given moment, when you want power and you just open sort it, it will shift like it is actually a tachometer. Wow. Here we go. And now as I come across corners, I realize there's so much grip on offer. So sure-footed. What a fun machine. It also sounds quite good, actually. I cannot take that away from Indian. Here we go. Taking a U-turn does take some effort on this bike, but once you get used to it, now it's all fine. But I love how it pulls. My goodness, what an engine. I know I said it like 15 times already, but you know what I mean. You know, the engine is just spot on. The way it revs, oh my lord, wow. And it's in every gear you open throttle. It just takes you and throws you like it's a javelin. That's the kind of performance it has on offer. So they have absolutely nailed it with the motor. Lovely machine. So this actually is sitting on top of the Indian Scout 60 and below the regular Indian Scout, because the pricing at 16.20 lakhs is quite a lot. But then you get exclusivity like no other. And here we go as I open the full throttle. Just doesn't shift. So should you buy one? A definite no, not with this gearbox at least. And the fact that the ride quality is very, very, very bad. It's so stiff, I have no words to tell you. But if you want something which looks the part and can accelerate the way this one does, then honestly, nothing else comes close in terms of performance
and desirability. So guys, this is the Indian Scout Bobber for you. Lovely looking motorcycle, offers a ton of performance but has a very shit gearbox, and the ride quality is absolutely pathetic. So on that bombshell, I'm going to end this video and vlog, and I hope you guys enjoyed it. And if you did, you know what you have to do, give it the thumbs up. I'm still not in first gear, still coming into neutral. So give it the thumbs up, that is the like button, and also subscribe to the channel. I will see you guys in the next one real soon. Bye bye.
It's a good motorcycle with the shittiest gearbox I've ever encountered on anything. And I was telling you that U-turn is difficult, but look, I'm not putting my foot down. It's quite easy once you get used to it. You're like, f*** this shit. And there is my squad, our long-term Elantra and motor beam, and the Maruti Ignis. Here we go. Time to stop Blue Squad.